Hello and welcome into the 24/7 Sports College Football Show. I'm Cooper Battaglia. That's Andrew Ivins. And Drew, I got to admit, week zero blew away all my expectations. We had SMU Nevada right here on the network. We had Georgia Tech springing the upset against Florida State. If you stayed up late, we had Delaware State, Hawaii as well, New Mexico State, Bronco Mendenhall. Couldn't get past Montana State. Nonetheless, it was a pretty good opening weekend slate. Drew, you look back on it. You and I were talking about it before the show. Is there one ranking from week zero you look back on? You're like, you know what? I'm pretty proud of that high school ranking I had on that player.
Not an easy one, given some of the performances from former five stars out there. But how about Amari Harvey, cornerback for Georgia Tech? This is a kid that's originally from Tallahassee. And Cooper, I always say this, right? The kids in the Sunshine State, when they have a chance to go against Florida State, Miami, Florida, they always seem to rise for the occasion if one of the big three didn't take him. I thought Amari Harvey, he's a kid that we tucked in the back of the top 247 there in the class of 2021. He came up big, seven tackles, had a key fourth down stop. We'll see if he gets drafted, but one of those ones where you look up and you're like, oh, whoa, that's Amari Harvey making plays. That's what I remember. And I dug back into the scouting report, said willing open field tackler. I think we saw that Saturday in Ireland.
You got that part right. That Georgia Tech secondary flying around, that Georgia Tech defense, big proponent of why Georgia Tech was able to get that win. Let's talk some Georgia Tech, Drew, to open the show here. A huge win. You look back the first year of Brent Key. Last year, they go 7-6. He took over for Jeff Collins, who was 10-22 in his time. Brent Key, native of Birmingham, Alabama, played four seasons at Georgia Tech, was a team captain, was obviously tied to this place. Georgia Tech's one of those programs, I think, for a lot of times, people have looked at kind of second-tier, Power Four program. How did they take that next step? Well, Drew, let's take a look under the hood. This is a team that continues to climb in the recruiting rankings, 33rd last year. They're top 20 right now. They're moving up the board. Just got another commitment today from a top 247 defensive lineman and Christian Garrett. But, Drew, they've been able to piece it together and become one of the best in the ACC conference running programs there behind Haynes King and guys like you go down the list and see guys like Jamal Haynes as well, converted receiver. Drew, pretty interesting. We're going to talk about the team talent composite 24/7 that they released last week. But Georgia Tech, one of those teams moving in the right direction. And one of those teams, if you're looking for a formula of, all right, how do you kind of continue to inch your way closer to a college football playoff if you're a non-traditional brand, Georgia Tech might be a team to follow here.
You're right, Coop. And that was kind of my takeaway coming out of the weekend. We're going to this 12-team playoff. I think we're in every year we're going to have, right, these four to five super teams, right, with the $20 million roster, with all the big names in the transfer portal, the four and five stars. I think we're going to have four to five of those every year. And then I think the other four to five spots, it's going to come down to a pool of 20 different schools, and every year it's going to be a different kind of group that's in the mix. And I think the formula is exactly what we saw from Georgia Tech. So what did Georgia Tech do? Well, they've recruited well from the high school ranks for their program. A lot of three stars out there on Saturday were making plays. They've found some good additions via the transfer portal that maybe don't have a huge price tag next to their name, but they can come in and fill some holes. So they had some impact transfers, right? And then the culture there at Georgia Tech, it was a tough team at the point of attack. Both line of scrimmages, I thought they kind of willed their way to that victory as the game wore on. And then finally, I think the offensive and defensive system that Brent Key has set up, right? He's got Santucci, the defensive coordinator, in there, Buster Faulkner, the offensive coordinator. What they want to do on offense, what they want to do on defense, it fits the players they have inside the building. They're recruiting to that scheme. So to me, we look forward to 2025, 2026. I think it's going to be these programs that are smart with their money. They're still getting talent from the high school ranks, supplementing it a little bit with some veterans. And then they got a capable quarterback, and Haynes King came up big at key moments. He did that last season as well. Let's not forget, he's a former Elite 11 finalist, bounce back guy, but he's starting to look like the kid we thought he could be coming out of high school.
We're going to talk a little bit about Florida State, Mike Norvell, a little bit later in the show. And one of the things that we're going to talk about, did Florida State capitalize on the recruiting trail when they went 13-0 in the regular season last year? Drew, how important is it for Brent Key right now, starting off 1-0? I mentioned 7-6 last year, the first time that they've done that in some time, getting to a bowl game and winning one. How important is it for them to really kind of seize this momentum that they're having on the field and be able to translate that into recruiting success off the field?
It's the name of the game. And, you know, week zero, this is what everyone was watching. Everyone knows that Georgia Tech took down Florida State, and now they're in prime position to capitalize on the recruiting trail. You look at Georgia Tech's 2025 recruiting class. It's currently ranked 19th nationally. That's pacing for the best ever in the modern recruiting era. They got a five-star tackle committed in Josh Petty, a four-star corner in Daylon Penson, Christian Garrett, a top 247 defensive lineman that was previously committed to the Georgia Bulldogs. Well, he announced this morning that he is committed to Georgia Tech. I really like this recruiting class. I mean, you can go up and down the list. Sam Turner, an in-state wide receiver. Grady Adamson, a quarterback out of Oklahoma. These are key guys, and I think for Georgia Tech, it's so important to strike while the iron is hot. And you look at Brent Key again with what the emphasis they have placed on the high school recruiting. I think there might be some more fireworks out there for the Yellow Jackets, but it's very, very important, Cooper. I mean, you've been on the other side. You've sat in those chairs. You get a victory like this, it's much easier to pick up the phone and call some of these recruits.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think the other thing for Georgia Tech and Brent Key, this is a program, Drew, you mentioned culture. They're starting to take on the identity of their head coach. And what I mean by that, I mentioned that they were number one in the ACC in rushing last year. They were top 15 in the country. They came out and they bludgeoned Florida State. We heard Pete Thamel talk before the game that this was one of the most talented defensive lines in all of the country in FSU. And they took it to them. They took it to their strength of the defense, their identity of Florida State's team. That's what I like so much about what Florida State's doing. The other thing, the culmination of that, how do you build a contender, a college football playoff contender at Georgia Tech, especially on both sides of the line of scrimmage? Well, doing what they're doing right now, Drew, you mentioned now they're up to four players in the top 247. Two of those guys come to the line of scrimmage, the five-star Josh Petty and the other one they got today in Christian Garrett. Drew, five starters on the offensive line. They have 123 starts between them. Like I said, I mentioned the talent composite. There's a little bit of a pattern going on between that experience at the offensive line and both sides of the point of attack. I think that's where Georgia Tech, you've seen them be really successful, and it doesn't hurt to have a guy like Haynes King. That certainly adds a very different dimension to Georgia Tech and their offense. Drew, I want to bring back up the schedule again, and I kind of want to ask, because this is not a position that people thought Georgia Tech was going to be in, getting the week one victory against Florida State and Mike Norvell, but how high could Georgia Tech and the Yellow Jackets really climb here in year one, coming off a 7-6 season? And instead of talking about the future, do you think it's within the realm of possibilities that they could potentially run the table and go win the ACC this year in 2024?
Well, I think there's a chance they can get to 8-9, potentially 10 wins, and I think that would be enough to be in the college football playoff conversation. Look, we said it, the offensive systems, the defensive systems, I think it sets up perfectly. A lot of pre-motion snap, and I think Georgia Tech, they took that vaunted front seven for Florida State really out of the game with a whole bunch of eye candy, a whole bunch of designs before the snap. You know, they constantly got to the edge with a player like Jamal Haynes, who, you want to get really in the nitty-gritty of scouting, Cooper, we were talking about this. I mean, that's a former wide receiver that has made the transition to running back. And really, as the game progressed, you could see a guy that used to run routes. I mean, he was very elusive in space, some dynamic cutbacks. I thought that was very interesting that we just saw a guy who had changed positions to find so much success against that defensive front. So, yeah, I think Georgia Tech is all the makings to be one of these teams that is a thorn in the big dog side. You don't want to play them on a short week. You don't want to play them when you're dinged up, right? Just because of everything they want to do on offense. They want to slow the game down, shrink the game. I mean, there was only seven offensive possessions for Florida State. I thought it was an excellent game plan again for Buster Faulkner. And then Tyler Santucci, defensive coordinator coming in from Duke, the way he dialed it up, only one sack in the game, but it seems like Florida State really didn't have a ton of time back there to set up shop.
If they can keep that going defensively, that was their biggest issue last year. I think we're going to talk about Tyler Santucci maybe as one of the best coaching hires of this cycle. Give Brent Key a ton of credit for bringing him in. That was a big one, keeping him away from Mike Elko coming over from Duke and not going to Texas A&M. Drew, the last five games of their schedule, you look at it, Notre Dame, Virginia Tech, Miami, NC State, and then at Georgia. GT has one of the most difficult schedules in the country. Drew, last thing I'll ask you on the recruiting front as we get back to that. Georgia Tech is really not known as a talent acquisition program. They have shown some things under Brent Key the last two cycles and here in 2025. Where do you think their ceiling is, at least on the high school side, in terms of how high they could potentially go? Is it top 20? Is it top 25? Maybe top 15? What do you think about the Yellow Jackets in their future?
Well, I think the big issue is, right, who's also in the state? That would be Georgia. And Georgia is going to have its pick of the litter with the in-state prospects. But the Peach State churns out a ton of talent, right? And normally you have the other schools from the SEC, the other schools from the ACC. They want to get in there and they want to recruit those individuals. I think for Georgia Tech, what works in their favor, and we've seen it a little bit, Brent Key has set up shop, right? They want the local talent to stay there, play in the ATL, but they also venture out into some other states. You'll see them in Florida. You'll see them over in Alabama. They've dipped into the Carolinas a little bit. Cooper, Atlanta's one of the biggest airports in the world. It's an easy flight. I think it's a smart strategy to kind of branch out a little bit, try to find some playmakers, because with the flights, it's not that far. And Atlanta is a big city. Kids want to play there. So, you know, I think top 25 every year is certainly obtainable for them. This as a chance to be, you know, the highest ranked recruiting class ever here in 2025. And if they can continue to win games, you think that's going to give them a boost in 2026. And really, that's the name of the game, right? Stacking recruiting class after recruiting class. And I think that too deep for Georgia Tech, when you look at it, a lot of young talent to be excited about.
All things coming up, Georgia Tech and Brent Key over the last 48 hours. But there was somebody on the other side of that field. That's Florida State. We'll talk about them after the break. Georgia Tech springs the upset over top 10 Florida State in Dublin, Ireland. Drew, the only thing that I could think of watching that game was how much and how many Florida State fans were there in Dublin, Ireland. That had to be a long ride home back to the States. But Drew, now the time to overreact a little bit. And I ask you very simply, panic or patience when it comes to Florida State and their 0-1 start?
I would go with panic. And yeah, Coop, if you were on Knowles 247 Saturday night, a lot of Florida State fans not happy about flying across the pond to see them play in person, looking for some refunds there. I thought it was just an overall disappointing performance for the Seminoles. And you know, what comes to my mind is the construction of this roster after the 13-0 season, the playoff snub with Jordan Travis getting hurt. You look, 17 transfers in, 9 of them from the SEC. At times, it didn't seem or felt like there wasn't a ton of fight from the Seminoles. And the wide receiver position, I know DJU is catching a ton of flack on social media and on the message boards. To me, I don't know about the wide receivers. And for Florida State to lose Keon Coleman, Johnny Wilson, that was the strength of the offense last year, in addition to Jordan Travis. It just didn't seem like they had the perimeter playmakers. I know Hakeem Williams, former five-star recruit, former guy on my freaks list, he was out with an injury. Sounds like he could come back later this season. But Florida State wanted to run the football. Aside from that opening drive, they weren't really able to do it. So I would be in a bit of a panic mode, especially when you look to the next few games on Florida State's schedule, right? Boston College, Labor Day weekend. Then they're going to take on Memphis the following weekend. This is I have more questions than I do with answers on Florida State.
Can I give a double-sided answer? I would say yes. The answer is to panic, but it depends on what your goal is. If your goal coming into the season, which I would assume for every Florida State fan would be to compete for a national championship, then absolutely I would panic. Now, if you're wondering about adjusting expectations after losing to Georgia Tech and being upset and still being able to run the table and maybe win 10 games, then have patience. I think that is something that is incredibly doable as well. But Drew, looking at this game, you talked about a team that didn't get off the bus. You know, we have that image of Charles Lester, the former top 247 recruit, eyeing down Georgia Tech. This was not a team ready to play. In every phase of this game is kind of what it felt like outside of that opening drive for Florida State. But let's talk about DJU a little bit. You and I talked about him on last week's show, whether or not this could be the guy that would be a multiplier to be able to push Florida State over the edge. And I think simply the answer is no. We've seen enough of DJU in his career at Oregon State, at Clemson, now at Florida State through one game to know that this is not the guy that's going to be able to bring you to a national championship. And if he was, then the environment around him would have to be absolutely perfect. He would be throwing the ball to Keon Coleman and Johnny Wilson, those caliber of players, not Malik Benson, not Jaylen Brown, not those type of guys. I also thought the right side of the line of scrimmage on the offensive line really, really struggled. Georgia Tech, you talk about bringing the wood and the guys that completely set the tone. It was Georgia Tech throughout the entire game. But Drew, it kind of brings up a broader question. Mike Norvell has been given so much credit, and rightfully so, for the job that he's done in the portal. But how sustainable is this year over year when you lose guys like Jared Verse and Braden Fisk? And a lot of people would look at you and say, well, it really wasn't the defensive line that I was worried about coming into this game. When you got guys like Pat Payton, Marvin Jones coming over from Georgia, Daryl Jackson, that really wasn't the question mark. But GT almost rolled on them for 200 yards in this game as well. So they challenged their manhood, and I think Georgia Tech at the end of the day was the more physical, stronger team. And Drew, as we zoom out in this quarterback situation, it's kind of interesting as you and I talk about it. Who's next, right? Is it Brock Glenn? Is it Luke Cromenhawk, a guy that we were really high on? And how ready is a guy like Cromenhawk or Brock Glenn to play if DJU is not the answer this season, which we'll see. It's a little bit early, but at some point, let's say they want to pivot and go in a different direction. It kind of gets your mind going a little bit like, hey, where is Florida State in terms of projecting this team out over the next year or two?
Coop, Braden Fisk, Jared Verse, where did they come from before they ended up at Florida State?
Albany and Western Michigan.
Just saying, you know, some of the SEC transfers that came in, I think they might have arrived at Florida State expecting to win football games, because that's what the Seminoles did last year. Again, I'm just kind of wondering about some of the buy-in at some of those key positions, notably up front. Patrick Payton, remember, he was in the transfer portal there for a hot minute. Sounded like he wanted to get more on the NIL side. He ends up returning, never actually transferring or filing the paperwork. But what does that do to your locker room? And I don't have a pulse. I'm not inside there. I'm not covering this team day to day. But it just didn't seem like there was a ton of grit, a ton of aggressiveness in the trenches. And I wonder if that's bled to other parts of the defense. I think the other thing for Florida State, you know, those linebackers, the run fits, I thought that was kind of where the huge issue was for the Seminoles. And I mentioned this to you over the weekend. You know, the Sunshine State, the state of Florida, it's referred to as a recruiting hotbed. But if you look at the linebacker position, right, off the ball type of guys, the state, I think, has produced one NFL draft pick in the past 5 years when we're talking about linebackers. It's just not a position the state produces well. And I think for Florida State, you know, they have to go to other parts of the country to find those individuals, or they got to go get them in the transfer portal. And they didn't do that this cycle to supplement this roster. On the quarterback situation, hey, Brock Glenn, I remember when he committed to Florida State, I wrote scouting take. I think he kind of reminds me a little bit of Jordan Travis. And you dig into their profiles coming out of high school, near identical testing metrics, near identical statistical production at their respective high schools. Brock Glenn out there in Memphis, Jordan Travis was down in West Palm. I know we saw him late in the season last year in the ACC title game against what is essentially an NFL defense in the Orange Bowl against Georgia. I don't know. I'm starting to wonder, you know, what would it take for Mike Norvell and that staff to potentially give Brock Glenn a look? Does the offense have to look out of sync against Boston College and Memphis? But certainly Brock Glenn is someone that I'm kind of wondering where he stands as the season progresses.
And let's not put it all on DJU. You know, the kid went, I think, 19 for 27 with 193 yards. I thought he did some things well. He played within the system. He's got to be better, but everybody's got to be better. The receiver's got to be better. The O-line's got to be better. The run game has to be better. And Mike Norvell has to be better. I thought he did some things late in the game on the move. They got the RPO involved rarely at the end of the game as well. And they had some success on that last drive. Let's see if they take that in to the next couple of weeks. Florida State looking to bounce back after an 0-1 start. We'll get to the 24/7 Sports Team Talent Composite right after this break. .247 Sports released its 10th annual team talent composite last Thursday. And Drew, I had the honors of writing a nice 1500 word plus article on the team talent composite, everything that goes into it. And I had a blast doing it. First time doing it. And you get to learn a lot about who's who and who are some of the most talented rosters in all of college football. And no shock here, Drew, for the seventh consecutive season, Alabama, Georgia, and Ohio State have finished all in the top three in some type of order. You talk about dominance since the talent composite has started since 2015. Same, same, but different. Alabama at the top. New head coach after 17 years in Nick Saban, but Kalen DeBoer inheriting the most talented roster in college football. We'll talk about that in a second. But Drew, you read the article as a friend. Let me get your feedback. What were the one or two things that kind of stood out to you?
The parity that's coming to college football. I thought the nugget you had in there, 12 teams over, what was it, 890 points in the talent team composite. You compare that to 2023, where there was only eight of them. So to me, we keep talking about this 12-team playoff. We mentioned Georgia Tech. Okay, how do you get a seat at the dance? I think more and more programs are going to have a chance to kind of break through. Now, it might be in waves. You kind of have to build to it, and you're going to have to retain and develop. But it certainly seems like the 12-team playoff has opened up opportunities for a lot more schools. And I think that's what they wanted to do when they expanded it.
Well, there's been some undercurrent, I think, with us kind of studying recruiting and some of the teams that have maybe moved from that second tier into the first tier, not quite Alabama, Georgia, and Ohio State, but the Texases and the Oregons and the LSUs of the world. And kind of what is it looking like? Who can win it on any given year? And Drew, here's the interesting part about this. Over the last 3 years, you've had teams like Washington, TCU, Cincinnati, all ranked outside of the top 15 that have made the college football playoff. And you look at them, Washington was ranked 26th, TCU 32nd, and Cincinnati was ranked 54th, the lowest to ever do it to crash the party. They all had some kind of semblance. And what I mean by that, maybe a little pattern to follow, right, when you look at the cookie crumbs, but all three of those teams broke records for number of NFL draft selections in those years. And the team, the first team to win the national championship ranked outside of the top 10 of the 24/7 Sports Talent Team Composite was Michigan. Last year, they had 13 NFL draft selections. That led all colleges, Drew. And they also had a first-round draft pick in J.J. McCarthy. Washington also had Michael Penix, Desmond Ridder. Say what you want about him now with the Arizona Cardinals. But that was a guy that went day two of the NFL draft as well. So we talked about that experience with Georgia Tech and the offensive line, but that experience with TCU, that experience with teams like Washington that won the Joe Moore Award on the offensive line. Cincinnati and Luke Fickell had 9 draft selections in 2021. That was only behind Alabama and LSU. That NFL caliber talent with experience, with high-level quarterback play, Drew, those are the things. If you want to break through that top 15 threshold and you want to win this thing, I think that's the way you do it. It's a combination of those two things.
Well, everyone always asks, why do our rankings reflect towards the NFL draft? Why is the NFL draft our North Star? You get NFL talent, it seems to elevate you and kind of push you through. Cooper, I wanted to ask you about Clemson, right? They remain in the top five. So much is made about Dabo, him not being in the transfer portal, all an organic homegrown roster. You know, they're still there. So they're still getting enough guys, enough blue chippers, and they have reached the college football playoffs six times in the last 9 years. Only other program that has done that more is Alabama. It feels like this weekend when they take on Georgia, we'll know what Clemson is really about.
The irony of this is exactly what Dabo Swinney has been preaching, right? The culture, the player development, the retention as well. He doesn't have players leaving in droves. So to me, when I see this and I see Clemson in the top five, something is not computing for me. These guys are still recruiting at a high level, maybe not the level that they were recruiting five, six, 7 years ago under Dabo Swinney, but they're still recruiting at a very high level. And you see guys like Peter Woods, Tamarion Parker, you go down the list year in and year out, they do an incredible job with talent ID and evaluation. But Drew, yes, it is going to be fascinating to see if Dabo Swinney's roster building philosophy is built for the brutality of new age college football. And it's not like Georgia is one of those teams that has gone out there and just abused the portal, but they have gone out there to get some starters at a position like the receiver position, like London Humphreys or Colby Young out of Miami. They had Ra-Ra Thomas before he was off the team as well. They have used it in a way that you would think Clemson would probably use it if they were ever to get involved, address some depth, go out, get some starters at some positions that maybe aren't as expensive and they're a little bit more of a market for and a dime a dozen. So the irony here is now you have a Georgia team at full strength, not only from a talent acquisition and development standpoint, but they've supplemented their roster incredibly well going up against a Clemson team that is homegrown, relied on player development. And you know what? They're one or two injuries away at some key spots where you're kind of scratching your head a little bit and you're saying, wow, I would have loved if they went in the portal and maybe addressed this. So it's going to be interesting to see that matchup, Drew. I know we're going to talk about it maybe a little bit more in depth. But were you surprised at that at all? I mean, you and I have covered Clemson very extensively over these last 3 years. Does that surprise you, Clemson's still among the best in the country?
Well, you really, when you think about it, I mean, consistently top 10 recruiting classes. We know the two deep is lined with players. You mentioned depth, okay, 12-team playoff expanded season. I think that's always been the question about the Tigers, right? Can they stay healthy? Do they have enough backups, or are the true freshmen going to be ready to go? So surprising when you see it at first glance, but then when you think about it, okay, they have gotten a ton of blue chippers. We go to the All-Star games, right, at the end of the season's end during the holidays. Clemson is very well represented there. I think the biggest thing for them is, okay, what is going on at quarterback? Because there's not a lot of 4- and 5-star quarterbacks that have been baked into that number for them. That has become a major question mark moving forward post Cade Klubnik. Cooper, the other thing I thought interesting about your story, some new highs for programs. Texas at number 4. Oregon at number 6, Kentucky at 24. They got some NFL guys on that roster. Any of them you are kind of really surprised by? I think Oregon is one that stands out to me.
How about Mizzou at number 19? You know, and that's a team with Eli Drinkwitz. What they've done from a talent acquisition standpoint, it seems like once the Luther Burden domino fell, and then you're able to couple that with some on-field success, everything's been moving in the right direction for Eli Drinkwitz in Missouri. You know, you go out, you get guys like Williams Winery last cycle, pair him with a guy like Courtney Crutchfield, who will backfill some point, Luther Burden. Drew, they've just done a really, really good job, not only with the top-tier talent in their state, they've done a good job in the portal, guys like Caden Green, and they supplement that with guys on the back end of their roster that you'll see over the next 2 to 3 years once they get in their player development program. So Missouri was one of those teams. Oregon is not a shock. They're at number 6 right now. I only expect them to climb. I think Oregon, Texas, both sitting there in the top 6. Those would be the two teams if I'm the top 3 and I'm Alabama, Georgia, and Ohio State. If I'm looking at one or two teams to really kind of close that gap into that top tier, and those guys are in their own tier, believe it or not, Texas Oregon, Steve Sarkisian, Dan Lanning, two guys very familiar with Nick Saban and Kirby Smart. Those would be the two teams that I would be watching. And Drew, on the flip side, it wasn't all good, right? You got USC down to a new low at number 15, LSU at number 9. You know, you look at USC, Drew, this is one of those teams. It just kind of seems like they're in cultural flex. You and I joke about it all the time. They continue to throw their hat in the ring, compete in the state of Georgia for top tier players like Justice Terry, Isaiah Gibson. You can go all the way back to Mykel Williams. Is it working? No, I don't think so. I'd like to see them get back to a little ground and pound style on the recruiting trail on the West Coast. If you go back and you look at the players from the state of California, if they just would have kept them there, Brock Bowers, Mason Graham, the list goes on and on of those caliber of talents, USC would be in a very different position. So I wonder if Lincoln Riley is going to take a step back, maybe address this in the offseason. They went full tilt on Courtney Morgan and kind of readdress this personnel department, their vision for this place. How do we get USC back to being on top? Right now, Drew, it's nowhere near good enough to win a national championship, in my opinion.
Hey, LSU at 9, I want to see where they are this time next year, because I love this recruiting class they have coming in. We'll see how many of them finish with that 5-star, 4-star designation. My freaks list, you could have put, I don't know, 12, 13, 14 of the LSU commits on there. I really like this group they have coming in. We'll see when you plug it in the calculations, but I'm not concerned about LSU being at number 9 right now. With the way Brian Kelly's recruiting, I think they're not too far off from where they need to be.
It's not everything either, right? The one thing I'll say, Georgia Tech sitting number 46 in the composite team talent rankings. FSU, number 13. That was a new high under Mike Norvell. So always keep that in consideration, guys. We're not done here. High school football is also back as well, as we look at some of the top players in the country as they debuted their senior seasons this past weekend. All right, we've talked about the present. Now it's time to talk about the future. We'll call this a look to the future. And Drew, we're recruiting guys, so sometimes you got to look into your crystal ball a little bit and you got to project out. But one guy that we are really excited about, the number 2 signal caller in the country, 5-star Ohio State quarterback commit, Tavian St. Clair. And man, what a weekend for him. 290 yards, 17 to 32, 4 touchdowns, 70 yards rushing, 2 touchdowns on the ground, leads his team to a 45-14 victory over Sydney on the road. Went back, watched the tape this morning. This dude is everything you want. He's prototype. We know about the clay physically, but Drew, the strides on the field that he continues to take, it's hard for a guy ranked number 2 in the country to say, yeah, the arrow's up on this guy. I don't know how much more he can climb. But we feel really, really good about the prospect of Tavian St. Clair.
Coop, we set the stage for this senior season. It's a battle between Tavian St. Clair and Bryce Underwood, the LSU commit, for that number 1 position. We almost moved Tavian St. Clair ahead of Bryce coming out of the Elite 11 finals, where he was the alpha dog for us. But we said, hey, we're going to wait. We want to see what these two do on the field in pads. And so far, Tavian St. Clair, he's played a game. Bryce Underwood hasn't, but you got to kind of give the edge to Tavian St. Clair. I think what's notable here, Cooper, Tavian lost his top 2 receivers to graduation, so he's working with a new supporting cast. He was very efficient. You mentioned him physically last night in our rankings group chat. I sent a photo of him. This guy looks like he could play right now in, you know, on Saturdays and potentially even Sundays. I mean, he is 6'4", 225 pounds. I think what really stands out about him, aside from the arm talent, is just how comfortable he is on the move. He's an efficient distributor. He's everything I think we thought he would be when he first came across our radar. Remember, this is a guy that started as a 3-star prospect, moves into the top 247, moves into first round territory for us, climbs all the way up to number 2. Some of these other quarterbacks that we were high on very early in the evaluation process, they have faded down the stretch. Tavian St. Clair has continued to create momentum and answer a ton of questions. So super excited to see how his senior season plays out.
big physical dude. Drew, I think the other thing to think about if you're an Ohio State fan, you know, you got Will Howard probably off to the NFL draft after this. And then whose turn is it right now? A lot of people looking at Julian Sain, the former five-star. That's going to create a little movement in that room. You got guys like Devin Brown, Lincoln Kindholz, Aaron Nolan as well. If Tavian St. Clair had to run as number two next year, I think Ohio State, you'd still be in a pretty good spot there. All right, Drew, let's keep it moving. Five-star receiver Jerome Miles, have yourself a day, kiddo. 16 years old, 3 touchdowns in the upset over IMG Academy. Also had 125 yards receiving. Drew, I want to give you your flowers here. We were early on this guy. I was a little skeptical myself. He was 15 years of age at the time when we put him in the top 32, and he was committed to Ole Miss. Now one of those guys still trying to find his home. But elite-level competition, and I think a lot of people had questions about how Utah competition would fair against some of the best comp in the country in IMG Academy. He looked right at home, no problem, one of the best players in the country.
6'3", 215 pounds, Utah's fastest man ever, 10.36 in the 100-meter dash. How could you not like this kid, Cooper? Missed a good chunk of his junior season with a broken ankle, but he came back and he helped Corner Canyon win a 6A state title there in Utah. Now he's helped them take down one of the top NFL factories in all of America, IMG Academy. We like this kid. We're trying to figure out the wide receiver board. I think Jerome Miles is making a strong case that he might be wide receiver number two. We'll see how it shakes out, but so far, so good for him. I think it's the combination of the speed, the hands, that ready-to-play frame. Big, big fan of Jerome Miles.
He's got my vote. Drew, you got to see a couple of the top players in the country. Not a couple. You mentioned 50-plus guys in that Bishop Gorman, St. Thomas Aquinas game. Absolutely loaded. One of the guys you got to see was LSU five-star commit Derek Meadows. You also got to see Oregon commit Dallas Wilson this weekend as well. One of the top receivers in the country. Quick thoughts on those two guys.
Yeah, I mentioned it, right? We're trying to figure out this wide receiver board. Last cycle, Jeremiah Smith, Cam Coleman, Ryan Williams, Mike Matthews. It was a generational class. We didn't feel as good about the pass catchers a few months ago, but now that they're playing their senior seasons, I'm buying as much stock as I can. Derek Meadows, number 3 on my freaks list, a kid out of Las Vegas Bishop Gorman, 6'5", another burner. To me, Coop, having sized him up in person, this is what we wanted to know about the senior season. He had only caught 19 passes to date at the varsity level. What does he look like? Well, he had a 41-yard touchdown, had another nice long catch. I think to me, though, you know, not the most polished wide receiver at this stage. He has a ways to go. On the flip side, Dallas Wilson at Tampa Bay Tech, I call him an assertive wide receiver. He's a type of kid where no matter if it's a run play or a pass play, the ball's going the other way, he's going to make everyone on the field know he's there. He will drive guys out of bounds when he blocks. He had a nasty stiff arm over the weekend, over 100 yards receiving. I like him. Again, buying stock in these wide receivers. We'll see. I think right now we got 4 or 5 with the 5-star designation. We might get to 6 or 7 come January when the rankings go final.
High school football is back on the field between the white lines, but recruiting never sleeps as well as 5-star linebacker, the number 1 linebacker in the country, Jonah Williams, top 10 player, commits to Texas over LSU and Texas A&M. The number 1 player on Andrew Ivins' freaks list. If you've been paying attention, we talked about that last week. Guys, stick with us. We'll talk about some vital personnel matchups after the break. Touted quarterback transfer Cam Ward makes his highly anticipated debut this weekend in the Swamp as Miami, Florida are set to show down for a huge Sunshine State battle. And Drew, without further ado, let's look at some matchups that could dictate some of the biggest games in week 1 over the next few days. And let's start with Miami, Florida. The first thing that comes to my mind is Florida's right side of the line of scrimmage going up against Miami's vaunted defensive front. And Drew, Florida brings in the right tackle from San Diego State, Brandon Crenshaw Dixon, a guy that's played a lot of games, started 36 games for the Aztecs. He's also got a lot of size, 6'6", 310. Went back, watched a little bit of his tape from last year against UCLA, Leatu Latu. He is a big body, functional athlete, but I think he's going to have his hands full and pass protection going up against some of these guys like Reuben Bain, Tyler Barron, Akeem Mesidor, Barrow as well. Miami loaded in their front seven. I expect Lance Guidry to kind of heat up Graham Mertz and test that right side along Crenshaw Dixon and Damian George. Drew, they got to be able to protect. I think that's where it's going to start.
For me, Cooper, I think if Florida is going to win this football game, I think it's going to be loud. I think it's going to be hot in the swamp. They got to get Trey Wilson going. And I think when you look at Miami, okay, where is the weakness on the roster? It's in the secondary, and more specifically so, an inside slot corner. Who's going to be able to run with Trey Wilson? We saw a little bit of him last season making plays for the Gators. I think Billy Napier, very creative offensive mind, they can move Trey Wilson around before the snap. They can create some matchups. So who in Miami's defensive backfield is going to be able to man up with Trey Wilson? That, to me, is something I'm going to be keeping an eye on. Also, do you think DJ Lagway, five-star quarterback, do you think we see him get a chance, maybe a special package for the Gators?
That's a word on the street, is that DJ Lagway is going to play, and you'll see him quite a bit. Drew, this is a guy that they've invested in financially and is going to be the future face of their program after Graham Mertz. Expect DJ Lagway to play week one against Miami. Drew, another game that is very highly anticipated, Notre Dame at Texas A&M. And Notre Dame came out with their week one depth chart today. Six career starts between all five starters on the offensive line. That is not a good sign when you got guys on the opposite end like Nick Scowerton, Shamar Stewart, Gabriel Brownlow, Dindy, Shamar Turner as well. This Texas A&M defensive line could be one of the best in the country. Drew, I'm looking at Anthony Knapp at left tackle, Emil Wagner on the right side. They bring in Riley Leonard from Duke. It's one of those things, Drew, when you look at everything with Notre Dame, this is a team ready to compete for a college football playoff. But if you cannot protect, they're going to have issues. I think you would have liked them, hindsight 2020, to go into the portal this offseason, maybe have added an insurance policy. Now you got one of your younger tackles going up against one of the most talented defensive fronts in all of college football.
Hey, what about Connor Wegman? That's kind of the player I have circled for this matchup. I agree, point of attack in the trenches, protecting Riley Leonard. That's going to dictate the game. But to me, Connor Wegman, you know, you listen to the NFL draft scouts, that's a name that continues to come up. I think they're drawn to Wegman for the same reasons we were when he was coming out of high school. Big, athletic, got an arm, can make all the throws. You know, Evan Stewart is gone. He is no longer there in College Station. What does this Mike Elgo program look like? To me, Connor Wegman, he is in the spotlight on Saturday night.
I'm excited about Le'Veon Moss, too. Reuben Owens, a former five-star, out for this season. What does Texas A&M's backfield look like? I think Le'Veon Moss is going to be one of those guys that we're going to hear a lot more from this season. All right, Drew, Clemson, Georgia. We mentioned the litmus test for Dabo Swinney in the Tigers and what a test it is going up against the number one-ranked Bulldogs. Drew, who's it running back for Georgia? I think that's the biggest question mark. Will we see Trevor Etienne? There's a lot of conversation right now whether or not he'll suit up, possibly facing a suspension. Branson Robinson, Nate Frazier, any of those names ring a bell?
Branson Robinson, both these guys are used to be on my freaks list. Branson Robinson, man, he was a animal in the weight room. Deadlift, I think he was deadlifting over 600 pounds. I mean, he is short and stocky. Got around him at the Under Armour All-American game a few years ago. I expect him, from what I've heard, to have a big weekend. And then, you know, what about Oscar Delp at tight end? You know, Carson Beck, potential number one overall pick, leading the offense there for Georgia. Who's his go-to target? I punch it's going to be Oscar Delp.
Yeah, that running game for Georgia waiting to get going. Branson Robinson, Nate Frazier will have no shortage of opportunities. Drew, Sunday night we got USC, LSU, two defenses that need to get a lot better. But is there one or two names we should be looking out for from the Trojans or the Tigers?
What does Harold Perkins look like in Blake Baker's system? Friend of the Oyster Boys. He likes to dial it up, move guys around, bring a ton of pressure. Harold Perkins has played all over the front seven. I want to see what Blake has in store for him.
Yeah, Jacoby Lane for me is the guy from USC, big target, Miller Moss. What does that look like? LSU's defense got to clean a lot of things up, Drew. I think we're going to see a shootout there in Las Vegas. Guys, just a reminder, for more recruiting information, everything you need, you can find that on the 24/7 Sports YouTube channel, along with a lot of other great programming as well. For Andrew Ivins, I'm Cooper Patagna. Guys, we appreciate you joining us, and we'll see you next week.